afternoon, good evening, and good night, good people around the world. This is the Black Hat Chat, collaboration between myself, Lee Johnson, and Rev Kai over there.
A wave too early.
In the US. I switched it around today. So this is Black Hat Chat. We get together every Friday and just talk about witchcraft and magic and all things related. And if you have not checked out the links in the description, the link tree specifically, there are a few links in there for the Black Hat Chat. You'll find our Patreon and Ko-fi platforms where you can get 2 reviews a month of TV series and movies related to magic and witchcraft. We've ripped them to pieces.
Tomorrow we are reviewing a Discovery of Witches on our supporter channels.
Yeah, that's a good one. And you'll also find our Wildwood Temple on Discord server and the Facebook group. And yeah, that's where you'll find us. Go and join.
But not right now. Stay here for the chat.
Yeah. You can do that in the break. There you go. And we do have the poll up for the public, what's on the telly, between... Now I've forgotten.
Spirited Away and Warlock. All 3 Warlock movies. Oh.
Yes, okay. There you go. Well, I think that's a no-brainer anyway.
Seems to be. Spirited Away is drastically winning in the polls right now. So if you aren't Warlock, go stalk the ballot box. No, I'm kidding.
All right.
YouTube reminders. Please give us a thumbs up. Helps YouTube know that you like this video and you think other people should see it. And change your chat window, if you haven't already, from top chat to live chat. Top chat filters out stuff. It's supposed to just remove spam, but it removes all sorts of things. So switch it over to live chat so you can see everyone in the conversation, whether you're watching live or not, because if you rewatch the live chat, it'll default it to top chat there too.
Yeah, it's a bit weird that way. Lady Cabrera asks, where would I find the link to the Dream Circle you mentioned last week? If you go to the Wildwood Temple on Discord server,
it's in our Discord.
And then just give it a shout and we'll add you to Dream Circle.
Yep. So you do need to join the Discord server, and you'll have to, you know, go through the first page, the welcome and the rules, and follow the instructions to get into the server. And then you need to post in the server. You need to say hi or something so that we can get your profile to load so that we can add you to the Dream Circle.
Mm.
Just the way the bots run and all of that sort of thing. So.
Yeah, it's a good place to be. We just want to ask the question. We have done all of the sabbats over a 6-month period because we do both sabbats each time because we're on opposite sides of the planet. Would you like us to continue doing the sabbats, or would you like us to replace that with an astrology slot? Kai will do an astrology stuff thingy-majobby. With me, of course. I'll be here. But, you know.
Well, I was thinking that maybe we could do, you know, some general looking ahead type stuff, looking at the astrology and talking about its use magically. Like, this is a good Jupiter time, or these are good times for these kind of operations. And include some prayers, invocations, stuff that goes with that, you know, so that you'd be able to plan it. But I'm going to argue for the other side, even though the astrology show is my bag. We have cheated saying done all the sabbats, because I think it's different to talk about it when you're there in the season versus when you're thinking about what it was like half a year ago. You know, and we do talk about our past interaction with the holidays and that sort of thing, but it's not quite the same, I think. So we've each only been half a cycle, even though we've traded places. But it also doesn't have to be an either or. for the sabbats and the astrology. We can qu put the astrology show in somewhere else too.
We could always do an astrology or a Sabbath show next week and then do astrology the week after.
Yeah, but so we thought
Do
we'd,
that for them.
Lee and I were debating what are we gonna do next week. I'm like, just ask people. What do you want?
Right, well, so far we've got astrology. Richard said I was going to say Sabbats, but now I want the astrology. Lady Caprera said intense.
Oh, been having intense dream states. We'll check it out soon.
Oh,
Not
okay.
internet dream states. I've had some of those internet dream states. Like, oh, I spent entirely too much time down the Google rabbit hole today. Should not be dreaming about this.
I did that the other night. I was reading something. I think it was about cybernetic shamanism. I was having all these weird freaking dreams.
Yeah,
Couldn't even make sense of them.
when my dreams start presenting me information in the form of web pages, I have spent entirely too long doing research. It's like, nope, you need a break.
All right. Carry on telling us if you want sabbats or astrology. We may just do both at the end of the day, but let's hear what you want. All right, so today we're talking about labyrinths, which I absolutely love the topic of labyrinths. Unfortunately, I have not walked one.
Oh.
I did try and create one in my space one stage, but it wasn't big enough, so.
Yeah, I mean, that is one thing about labyrinths. They pretty much have to be outside because they are such a large space. And
Although you do get the finger labyrinths, which we'll talk
right.
about.
Yeah. Troy stones are the portable version of labyrinths that you can do anywhere.
Yeah, we'll talk about that anyway. All right, so when we talk about labyrinths, there is some confusion between labyrinths and mazes, even though labyrinths are often referred to as mazes. A maze is a pattern which has dead ends, and a labyrinth is a unicursal form which goes in a particular direction, and you keep flowing in a particular direction. Well,
Yeah. A
you keep
labyrinth
flowing around the path.
has one path. There are no choices in a labyrinth. When you walk the labyrinth, you simply follow the path and you go in and you come out. And there are no dead ends. The other thing, labyrinths tend to be wide open. They are laid out on the ground that you follow. Mazes tend to have walls and block your vision and have dead ends. And mazes and labyrinths are opposite things. They have opposite effects on the body. They have opposite employments in magic. So I always kind of shake my head at the mazes and labyrinths being lumped together, or especially when the words are used interchangeably, because no, they're the same technology, but their goals are very, very different.
Richard said that he and I should go for a walk, and the one that's not too far from me. Walked one once, and it was a great experience. There is one in Honeydew that I know of. It's usually mazes there. I think they do have Universal Labyrinth. But I think it's like tucked away and nobody uses it anymore. In fact,
On
Graham
that,
God.
oh, go ahead.
Yeah.
Oh,
He did. So, konnichiwa.
konnichiwa.
Hello?
It's good afternoon. But on that topic of going to walk a labyrinth nearby, the links in the description, at the very top of the description, there's three of them. The first one is called Labyrinth Locator, and it's a worldwide labyrinth locator, so you can find places to go to walk these labyrinths. So I think that's super neat. You can put in your address and it finds it for you. You never know where these things are. They're hidden all over everywhere. You know, there's one nearby, somewhere.
Yeah, I was actually looking at that for South Africa, and most of them are kind of like down by the coast or up in the north. Yeah, none around my immediate area, unfortunately.
Yeah, well,
Don't
nearby.
travel.
I'm from the US, where nearby means within
Oh,
3 hours drive, which is almost 200 miles away. So
yeah, okay.
we have different definitions of nearby.
All right. Infinite Dragon God did ask the question, Labyrinth. Yes, Labyrinth. There you go. That's the answer.
I also
Yes.
love David Bowie,
I
but
do
that's
like
not
him.
what we're talking about. And in fact, that's not a labyrinth. It's a
No,
maze.
that's a maze.
And
Oh.
Pan's Labyrinth, that's not a labyrinth.
No, although I'm
Be
trying to recall now, when she first goes down into that sort of well space, I'm sure there's a universal
I think there's a labyrinth drawn down there at the base, but she never walks it. So.
Oh, Lady Crow keeps dropping her phone. Don't drop
And
your phone. Doesn't help.
in Pan's Labyrinth, she has challenges to overcome, which go with mazes, challenges and confrontations and that sort of thing, because that's the energy of a maze is it invokes a stress response. It creates a choice. It creates challenge. That sort of thing. Whereas labyrinths are the opposite. So.
Yeah, so labyrinths are mostly used for meditation purposes, especially in modern times. I was reading that there's some records of specifically the Shepherd's Race maze in the UK. There was actually a booklet that was created with it, and there was actually a game involved with it. Now, where was it? Oh yes, yeah. It was kind of like a processional that they had, but this game you had to turn the corners in a specific way. If your foot wasn't in the right position, you were out and things like that. There's also speculation that it was older than the Romans and it was connected to fertility rites.
Yeah, I've read about that in some evidence we have from the Minoan culture. Of course, the Minoans are famous for their amazing paintings on pottery and walls and that sort of thing. So we have lots of illustrations of what they were doing. Not necessarily with details in text about what's going on, but we can guess from the pictures. And there seems to be fertility rites associated with labyrinths, various sexual positions associated with them, which may also be connected to dances and ecstatic dance kind of ceremonies, rituals, practices involved with labyrinths. From the Minoan culture and other cultures throughout the basin there. So I think that's really interesting, especially going along with the evidence from England, did you say it was? Or was it of like a game of you have to move your body a certain way or you're out? I mean, that sounds like, learning those prescribed dance steps as a kid, So we've got both like the rigid form dancing that has all of these certain movements and the idea of ecstatic dance and kind of a freeing, more like a slow body meditation like Tai Chi or walking meditation.
There's actually a lot of reference to treading the maze, which I find quite interesting, especially if we correlate that with treading the mill. Because as you're going around the labyrinth, you do relatively put yourself into a trance state as well, which is the whole purpose, to kind of calm yourself down, bring yourself into that meditative state, into a light trance state, and then when you get to the center, you can sit down and meditate.
Well, labyrinths are amazing because it's It's forced meditation. Whether you want to or not, you will end up in a meditative state because it cycles the breathing in a certain way. To be walking like that, you need a certain distance in order to do that. And the way that focus works in a labyrinth, you have to pay attention to where you're going. You have to look at the ground repeatedly. So you can't just completely wander aimlessly and look at the out at the world. You have to pay attention to your feet. But that doesn't consume all of your attention. But a lot of people describe the process of going into a labyrinth turns on another awareness for them. And they start to see things that they didn't see before. You know, noticing certain flowers or certain rocks or other things when they're continually looking at their feet, seeing where to go. So I think labyrinths are amazing, especially for people who feel like they can't meditate, because you will be in a meditative state walking a labyrinth. There is no choice.
I think it's actually something that's vital nowadays. I mean, we're so focused on our computers and our phones and stuff. To actually put that down and walk into a space where you can start noticing other things, because even when we put our phone down and we're just in our general environment, we still don't notice things, because we've still got our thoughts on on what was going on.
Yeah. Well, and see, mazes are the other way. They're meant to increase that internal chatter, because you're constantly making decisions with mazes, and it leads to a kind of exhaustion. That is the point of a maze. And so, you know, mazes were used for keeping people out. They were used as a sort of guardian kind of situation. They're defensive things because they exhaust your opponents. Labyrinths are never used like that. You don't see labyrinths as like the entrance to anywhere. They're not a defensive kind of thing because they're relaxing. But we do see labyrinths quite frequently in religious areas aligned with celestial phenomenon. There are many labyrinths that are aligned with the solstices or the equinoxes, because the sun's in the same spot on those days, so you can line stuff up, you know. So I think it's important to look at the differences between them and how they function. And I think labyrinths are all over the world because we figured out long ago that everybody needs to be in that meditative state for optimal health. Like you're talking about, we need to put down the phones and so on and so forth. But, you know, being in tune, having the right breathing rhythm, having the vagus nerve in a relaxed state, all of those things that we talk about in meditation, all of those physical phenomenon and all of that biofeedback, that all happens in a labyrinth. And all of that boosts the immune system, ups metabolism, increases organ function, suppresses cancer. I mean, all the things that, you know, we can list off for good health, walking in a labyrinth does it. And you don't need any training to walk in a labyrinth. You don't need any age requirements to walk in a labyrinth. Even children and people that were carried through labyrinths have experienced the same phenomenon through the tests that they've gone through with the biofeedback. So you don't even need to walk the labyrinth. You just need to move through it. And that is some amazing technology, just human technology, that we can offer that healing and connection experience to literally anyone.
Yeah. Does the same thing happen with the finger labyrinths?
The finger labyrinths actually take a little more training and focus. They're not as just automatic as walking a labyrinth. But if you can trace the finger labyrinth and especially connect it to an experience, a memory of an experience of walking the same labyrinth, then it works very, very well and very easily. And that's all you need to do, is recall the memory. If you don't have the memory and you have to create it using the finger labyrinth. That's the hardest jump.
I think also, I mean, from a health perspective, it's a hell of a long walk sometimes.
Yeah, it is. It's a very long distance in a very short space. It always reminds me of, we have how many feet, meters of intestines rolled up and packed up in our bodies.
True.
Labyrinths always feel similar to me, that it is this long journey of processing. I know that's probably gross, but I'm a garden person. All wound up in this little tiny space. Where you can, it's the most efficient.
But the Shepherd's Race, which is near the summit of Bluebell Hill, Thornywood Mount in the St. Anne's district of Nottingham. It's 35 to still 34 to 35 yards across, covering an area of 324 square yards, with a single path of 535 yards long.
Wow.
That's like half a kilometer almost.
That's more than that, isn't it? I gotta go do the conversions. It's a lot. 535 yards is a lot.
It was almost half a kilometer, or maybe more, just over.
T-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-t-5. Oh yeah, you're right. Half a kilometer. 0.489. Which is long ass way.
It is. But this is actually an interesting one because I think it originally was one of the old Chartreux formations. And then it's probably the church. They came along and they added turrets to the four quarters. Nice pattern to it.
Yeah. So there are lots of types of labyrinths. We're not just talking about, the classical 11 circuit, which is the most popular one. So we may bring those up on the screen, but I'll also point to the Labyrinth Society link down there in the description, where you can go look at all of these and look at these types of labyrinths and see them all. One thing I've always found fascinating is the idea that the Nazca lines are labyrinths, but they are in the shape of animals because they are connected to that energy power current somehow. People always look at the Nazca lines and they're like, what is that for? You can only see it from space. Well, you can only really see a big labyrinth pattern like that huge one there, the Shepherd's Race. You wouldn't be able to see that on the ground. You get a sense that it's there, but not the pattern. You'd have to be up in the air, So.
Richard said that I should try out the finger labyrinth. Yeah, give it a try, especially if you've just get one of the same pattern as the one you walked.
Yeah. That's important because the body remembers the pattern. And if you already have a memory to connect to, you will drop into that state. It's the same thing like learning invocation from a teacher. If you're there to experience the invocation and feel the energies, when you go to do it yourself, you already know what you're going for. You already have a memory of the feeling. And in this case, appropriate on Earth Day, the earth is literally the teacher in the labyrinth. You are moving through the energies of the earth. You are interacting with your body against the earth in a specific pattern and learning from the earth what it feels like to be in that harmonic meditative state that is like the pinnacle of human health. It makes all our body systems run the way they're supposed to.
Ask where are they in the US? Have a look in the links in the description. There's one for the labyrinth
Labyrinth.
locator.
Labyrinth locator. Yeah.
You can go check there. And small intestine is 9 to 16 feet and large is 5 feet.
So yeah, all that. Most people are not 16 foot tall. Very few people are even 9 foot tall. So all that crammed up in that little space. And there's a single way in and a single path. There's no choices, hopefully. I do not want the food passing through my body to be making choices about where it's going to go. And there's a single path out. But that's enough for my weird body relations to Labyrinth. Probably the only reference to that ever, because everybody else is like, ew.
Ew. There's actually a link I forgot to put in the description, which is quite good. It's the Edkins. I'll put it in the chat. There we go.
Oh, but it's also a
There's.
maze because you can't see where you're going.
Ah, you see.
Seriously, gonna try to stop now.
Still carrying on. You're still carrying on about your body parts.
I don't know what to say. My thing. I need concrete relational examples for all of my magic. I do. It's
It
just the way my brain works.
makes more sense
You
now.
know, and I find them in nature, and guess what's part of nature? The human body. Even though we live in a society where, you know, we don't necessarily discuss those things, such things are taboo. But I think
No, we
is
do.
yeah, I mean, witches talk about taboo subjects, and
Because we are taboo.
we live on the fringe, you
Yep.
know. And I usually clean up my language a lot more and talk about the compost cycle and fungi and, you know, life becomes death and decomposition and so on and so forth. But mazes and labyrinths, just that's not in a compost pile. That's in a set of intestines.
Yeah, we'll just have to bring intestines through just to
Oh,
make it.
I got another intestine link.
Okay, here we go.
Horoscopy. So, divining by the intestines of the sacrificed animal. Because when you go to butcher an animal, you have to remove the intestines anyways in order to clean the meat for the offering and everything else. And you do your divination on the offering. But in labyrinths, we enter that meditative state so that we can receive wisdom and divine and all of that sort of thing. So there's and
There we
the
go.
brain and the
So today on the Blackout Chat, we are talking about intestines.
Sorry. I'm just thinking of all these things now about how it all connects, you know, how walking aids
Does.
digestion and how it activates the neural network in the gut, which actually soothes the vagus nerve and actually can relieve anxiety and all of that, because most of those emotional responses are produced by the hormone centers near the gut, activated by that neural network. And
Makes
yeah.
perfect sense. Carry on.
All the connections. Crazy connections, I will
Oh, good,
absolutely
sits in
admit.
a corner.
This is supposed to be your thing. You're the one into labyrinths. I'm just into intestines, apparently.
Richard said taboo subjects are always interesting. Oh, of course. Because we're interesting. Because we're witches.
That our new slogan? Does it have to come with that? Oh, I was thinking like Rosie the
Those
Riveter.
pirates.
That's pirates.
Lady Capo's got to run. Driving back home from Reno. Again, we're
A safe
actually going
drive.
to drive, so. There was actually something, I can't remember, it was years ago I read this. I think it was in a Chas Everett or Evan John Jones book. When you walk, and it was specifically the Chatru formation, but you walk up, and then when you get to the center, you enter the castle. Pretty sure it was the Rose Castle they kept talking about.
That sounds
So it's more of a passage
vaguely
into,
familiar.
it's more of a passage into the other world, afterlife. Across the bridge on the west, that sort of thing. Yeah, I just can't remember where I read it actually.
Yeah, it sounds familiar, but I couldn't Couldn't tell you where in the world it was.
I've searched for it online. I can't find it, but I think it's specifically in a book, which nobody seems to have related onto a web page anyway.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right, so we have old maze or old labyrinths and new labyrinths. Let me go over here. Because we've got the Cretan. I'm confused with the Chartreux pattern, because the old Cretan or the classic ones are sometimes referred to as the Chartreux as well.
Let me pull up this here so we can show the Chartreux labyrinth. Zoom in.
Actually, some of the smaller Chartreux labyrinths actually remind me a lot of the Strophilos of Hecate.
Yeah. Now there is a Hecate labyrinth that is named that is not, I do not think historically associated with Hecate, but it's named that because it's based on Y, a three pattern to start the circuit. So I'm not sure. But there up on the screen is a Chartreux labyrinth. And of course, if you're listening to this, we're pulling these images from the labyrinthsociety.org link that's in the description. So you can go look at them yourselves if you want.
And those older, the older mazes, the classical, now I'm saying mazes, the classical labyrinths on that website, they've got little GIFs which show you how they are actually drawn. So
Which
like,
is fascinating. Of
says,
course, it's locked up on me now. Thanks. There we go. So I'll pull up the classic 11 circuit labyrinth and set the size correctly so it shows up on the screen. Because they're teeny tiny little images. Teeny tiny little images. This is the fun of a live chat. There we go. But it starts out there with a cross and then dots in the corners. And the 11 circuit labyrinth has three dots in the corners that are then expanded out. And I've heard some people talk about how these cross-based labyrinths, the 11 circuit, the 15 circuit, so on and so forth, look like brains.
They do actually, because it's got that flat bottom and then it's round, with the kind of windy, windy stuff. I can explain it, windy, windy stuff.
Paths, curves, spirals.
Something like that,
We use the word spiral in and spiral out very frequently when talking about a labyrinth because there's a lot of them that work that way. You start on the outside edge and you eventually work your way in and then you work your way out, but it's not a spiral. It's a labyrinth path.
There are
So,
some that are spirals.
there are some that are spirals. Let me see if I can pull up the Hecate one. I probably shouldn't call it that because that's not its name. It has another name. They all have names. And seed patterns.
Richard said the Chartreux Labyrinth is the one I walked. The lines were made of rose quartz.
That's cool. Well, now I can't find it. Of course.
Was it just no?
Oh, here it is. Chakra Vyuha. I probably said that wrong. Let me get it here where we can see it on the screen. There we go. If it'll run and do the thing. Do the thing! Nope.
Yeah, I wonder why they called it the Hecate Labyrinth.
The Chakra Vyuha Labyrinth. Just because it, I think it starts with that three, so it looks, you know, very similar to the, there goes my brain, the symbol of Hecate that has a name, the three.
Well, I mean, Hecate is the triple goddess of the three worlds.
Right. Now I have to
guide, guardian, and gatekeeper. It was related to three. Oh, you're talking about the crossroads.
The three-way key, Hecate's wheel. There we go. I was trying to. I thought it had a name. It's just called Hecate's wheel. Strophilos. That's the word. Thank you.
What I said earlier.
Sorry. I totally missed it. I'm sorry.
No, but that. That's the thing, the smaller chartreuse ones actually remind me more of Strophilos.
I know there is that one Strophilos pattern that is actually like a snake that winds around pegs. And so it's that single path that you trace.
Yeah.
But that is a differentiation. Labyrinths are not circular.
Well, some of them appear to be.
Yes, they often start with a radial symmetry pattern, but then the way the labyrinth paths are drawn, which are almost always from the left over the top to the right, you know, like the sun connecting the dots, they do not end up with radial symmetry. So they don't have that circular radial symmetry kind of aspect to them, even though they start that way.
Yeah. Pity I cannot display on screen. I'm just going to send you the link in the admin thing.
Here is the Strophilos we were talking about. Pull up just some Google images, and here is the one with the winding snake pattern where it's all one path. But this can't be a labyrinth because there needs to be a way in and a way out. For it to be a labyrinth. So,
go to that link I just sent.
Okay.
And go down to scaling the chartreuse maze up and down. And there's a small one on the left, red one. Looks so much like the Strophilos.
There we go. Yeah, I think it's that turning around the curve, you know, that looks that way. Gives me that feeling, because that has that in the Strophilos too. Now this, see, it doesn't have the continual path of the sun pattern on it, where it goes arcing, connecting. This is a back and forth around pattern, and while there is only one path, these are considered medieval. I think that's what they're called. The medieval labyrinths that are influenced by mazes.
Yeah.
So I don't know how a labyrinth purist anybody wants to be, if that's even a thing.
Yeah, because some of them are, you go in a certain way, and then when you get to the middle, you come out the same way.
Yes.
But some of them, you go into the center on a particular, on one path, and then you actually exit on a different path.
I thought those were the same thing, the two things you just said.
No. So the one, which is specifically the classic, or the Cretan, you start at one point on the outside, and you follow the path all the way through to the middle. But then you take the same path.
Oh. Reversed. So that you would be walking on the same path that you did before.
Yeah, just in reverse.
I didn't think those were labyrinths. I thought those were mazes.
No, like the Shepherd's Race. Hang on. Let's see. It's the ancient mazes on that page. Oh, I didn't send that page, did I? Yeah,
We're having all the fun. All the fun.
we are. On that, well, it's on that, right? Yes, it's on that web. No, it's not on that website. Yes, it is on that website. The
This here?
Edgins. If you go to the Cretan mazes,
Right.
that's the classical, you know, that one there, which is the round one. That's the classical one that you go in one way, you get to the middle, and you reverse, and you repeat the same pattern, but you come out.
But you, yeah, you do make the choice to turn around, don't you? So that was one of those things. A labyrinth has no end. One way out, one way in. These all, you turn around. You get to an
Yeah.
end and you turn around.
You get to your final destination. Look, stuff in the chat. Hang on. Deborah said, so one actually can make their own labyrinth.
Oh,
Yes, people can
absolutely.
make their own
Yeah.
labyrinth.
Yeah.
And dogs. I'm not sure what dogs refers
But you can make your
to.
own labyrinth. Ideally, you'd like to make the paths wide enough that, you can comfortably walk them. But especially if you're short on space, you're doing it in your backyard or something like that, big enough for a foot. And if it's only one person walking at a time, you don't have to really worry about that because you're not going to hit your neighbor as you pass. But, I've seen lots of labyrinths laid out at pagan festivals and that sort of thing. It's an opportunity to lay the labyrinth in a meditative state and then everybody can walk it. And those you always want to make sure that you have enough room for everybody to stay inside their paths because you're not going to build walls. And so when two people pass, you don't want to run into each other or have to worry about bumping into people because everyone in that labyrinth will soon be zoned out in. Tuned in, zoned out. And everyone will run into each other and fall over.
If you can build a permanent one in your garden, that would be perfect. If you cannot, what you could do, and if you've got a space inside or outside, which is, I found the minimum is about 5 meters. You know, you can make it a bit less, but a nice size is about 5 meters square. Then you can get a big piece of fabric, then you can print it on the fabric or draw it on the fabric, and then you can just lay it down. Just move the furniture away, lay it down on the floor, walk it, pick it up, move the furniture back. There you go. It's just it's the space that you've got to try and figure out.
I'm thinking it would have been so cool. We did a big labyrinth installation at a goddess festival I went to a while back, and for it, we gave everyone a stone as they entered the labyrinth. And they're supposed to rub it and hold it and everything else. And then they could take that and it would be their talisman. Would have been so cool if we'd gotten, a laser engraver or whatever and actually traced the labyrinth that we had created on those stones. Give everybody Troy or Maisie stones. That would have been way
That would be cool.
better.
Next
Next time.
time.
Next time.
Waste Yellow said there are 4,000-year-old rock carvings of labyrinth patterns in Cornwall. Great show again. Thank you. Thank you
Yeah,
for that.
it's amazing how old many of these labyrinth patterns are and how well they've survived.
Yeah,
It,
that
but.
was the one thing about the turf mazes was that they're cut out into the turf, and the problem was that they had to keep being maintained.
Right, because plants
And every
grow.
time that, yeah, but every time they were cut out, it would ruin the aging. So when somebody came along at a
Oh.
later date and tried to carbon date it or whatever they do, they couldn't because it had been cut out so many times, it just messed everything up.
The most recently maintained date, yeah,
Yeah.
would be all you could get out of it.
Something that. Deborah said so they are used for meditative reasons. Mostly, yeah. Something like being in the glass house at the state fair. Don't know what the glass house is. I'm in South Africa, so
No state fairs.
know. State fairs.
Not subjected to that weirdness. Yeah.
We take a break?
Yeah, I think we're at the break point.
Yeah, it's hot chocolate time.
So, if you have any questions about labyrinths or their use in traditional witchcraft or any of that sort of stuff, pop that in the chat while we take our break, and we will be back in a moment.
Welcome back to the Black Hat Chat, and today we are talking about labyrinths. All right, so I think we've covered most of the stuff about labyrinths. Let's talk about how they are used in traditional witchcraft. The one I know of is, as I mentioned, walking into the middle and then entering the Rose Castle, which is more of a transition not, it's, you get into a trance meditative state as you walk through, and then when you get into the middle, you actually go in between worlds.
Yeah.
So.
I would agree that this is definitely a form of treading the mill. And when we talked about treading the mill before, there can be a frenzy to it where it just gets faster and faster and faster, and then everybody drops. But it doesn't have to be that way. That's just one way of doing it. And labyrinths, I think, are wonderful because they are the solo practitioner's way to do all this stuff, that is usually done in groups. And you don't need any training. You don't need to have ever journeyed to the Rose Castle before. You don't need to have ever meditated before. You don't need to know anything about it. And you can do it with a labyrinth. Which, for all of the I can't find a teacher, or solo path is the only option for me, for whatever that reason, labyrinths are amazing tools. I would say to have in your back pocket, but first you gotta have not in your back pocket. First you gotta have big and on the ground
In your backyard.
in your backyard. Yeah, they're a great tool, but they're a big tool. They're a very big tool.
In fact, when
But
I was going through
oh, go ahead.
that labyrinth locator, I noticed a lot of them in, well, in South Africa anyway, are in people's private gardens that
Yeah.
they allow, by appointment, they allow people to come in and walk them.
Yeah. There's a lot of them in churchyards too. And there's a lot of debate over whether that was like building on pagan sites kind of situation where people had walked the labyrinth there for so long and wouldn't stop, or whether it was the church finding that this was a perfect way to have a long processional in a small space and it had a beneficial effect, and whether or not they were going for the meditative effect or not. This is a super useful religious tool, just as applicable to groups, especially big public groups. Covens, kindreds, small groups that work together. You train, you practice, you work together frequently, you get a rhythm together. A labyrinth is not a necessary tool in that case, it's a cool experience. But big groups of people, especially public gatherings, and people who have never experienced those states, I think labyrinths are an absolutely essential tool.
Yeah, because I mean, a lot of them are actually found not just on the grounds of the churches, but inside the churches and cathedrals. So they definitely took that over. I mean, there's a lot of speculation about where they originated. As we said,
Yeah.
they're probably much further back and were associated with fertility rites, but then some archaeologists are stating that they were Roman military something or other.
Really?
Yeah, something to do with the Roman military practice.
Hmm.
Which was a bit, that sounded a
Now,
bit
see,
weird, but anyway.
I could see mazes being used in the military because they would train you to react in those heightened states, in those challenge states under stress. Mazes create stress. Being in a maze creates stress. They're used as exhaustion defenses, but and they'd be great training tools so that you'd learn how to regulate in that state. Their mazes are, in folklore we associate mazes with the monster behind the next corner. They're used for fear. They're used to heighten all of that kind of stuff, which cool. But definitely not health improving like labyrinths are. I don't know. There's so much over the years where maze and labyrinth are interchangeable words, in archaeology, in everything. It's very hard to separate them out.
I'm just checking on what the Saffron Walden one, because it's stated here. This is about the Saffron Walden. I keep saying maze, but this whole page is about the turf mazes, which are labyrinths. Dr. Stuckley from Oxford stated that it is a Roman games field used for playing a game of mock military maneuvers called Troia Ludum.
Think that's where calling them Troil stones comes from? Because I've always wondered about that. Mazy stones. That's just maze. You know, that's a pretty easy linguistic connection, but Troil and Troy stones has always been weird.
So Troy Stones is probably from the Roman. Oh, Yolandi said I love drawing spirals when I doodle. Can this be seen as finger labyrinths? I think so, because when you're doodling, especially when you're drawing spirals, you can put yourself into a trance. Richard said there is of course the story of the Minotaur in the maze, not a labyrinth though. Yeah, I know. That's, I think that was just confused the Minotaur so it wouldn't get out. That was a protective thing.
So it couldn't leave the maze. The illusion of freedom.
Sort of thinks he's got a way out but cannot find it. Excuse me. Got a tickle in my throat.
So, Troil stones and mazy stones are the same thing. They are stones that have finger labyrinths on them. And the idea when you use them is that you trace the pattern with your finger and you recall the experience of being in that labyrinth. Or I suppose in that maze, although I wouldn't want to recreate that experience all that often, you know. But for most of them, you need to have experienced the labyrinth once already. That's the best way to do it.
The thing is, there's a lot of healing sites that are selling the finger labyrinths, and there's no mention of that. It's just take the finger labyrinth, trace it, and use it as a meditation tool.
I think it still works as a meditation tool, without that previous experience, just because it's, you know, focus distraction. Which is important, but people don't seem to get the same biofeedback reactions. Their respiration rate doesn't drop as low. They don't tend to enter alpha state with all of those markers of the change in the electromagnetic fields on the skin and all of that sort of stuff without having had the previous experience in a physical full-size labyrinth. So, you know, as a recall tool, as a trigger tool, that is, I think, the best way. If you don't have that, then there is imagining yourself in a labyrinth, using it with astral projection, using it with visualization, you know. And if that's not an option, then there is just tracing it. They're all still beneficial. They're all still working towards that meditative state. They're just grades of most effective, most beneficial kind of situation.
Not the same effect. Roop said, "Hi there. Damn, I'm late. Gotta watch." Yep, no. Can't be late. It was a good discussion today, actually. And Richard had to go. Eskom is gonna load shit. So.
Fun, fun, fun. Did anybody have any other questions, comments, thoughts, tangentially related intestine stories to go with Labyrinth today?
You're gonna have to watch the replay later because
That
you've got to find out about the labyrinth's relation to the intestines.
went off on a whole weird thing. I do
Think
really,
we've covered
oh, go
everything?
ahead. As I say, I really encourage everyone to check out those three links. We shared in the description if you're into labyrinths. There's so much to cover and so much to look at, of course, because this is also a visual thing we're talking about, you know. And so this is kind of a visual medium, but we also turn this into a podcast, so we try to have an audio side to everything. And you gotta go look at labyrinths. You gotta go look at the pictures, because describing an 11 circuit or a 15 circuit labyrinth just with words, I think, would get super confusing super fast. But seeing all of these labyrinths cut into the turf, seeing them, you know, made out of various stones, the Nazca lines, when I had that light bulb moment, ding, like these are the same human thing, it just, you know, connected all sorts of things in my mind, like connecting intestines today.
Oh, there you go. Intestines, Nazca lines, labyrinths. But now, talking about all of that, can we include crop circles in this?
See, I don't think crop circles are labyrinths. Yes, they're things you can see from up above. I mean, unless, of course, there is a crop circle that is a labyrinth pattern. But I don't think crop circles are like out to achieve, you know, meditative states, walking meditation, that sort of thing. And that's not the feeling people describe from experiencing them. You know, people go through mazes, they get scared, they get excited because it triggers adrenaline, it triggers fear, it triggers stress because of constant decision making. People go through labyrinths, they described being relaxed and connected, and ideas we connect with meditation. But people do not describe either of those things in crop circles. Perhaps
Yeah,
the
I know.
fear, there is an excitement adrenaline factor. So.
I'm just looking at the Nazca lines are definitely a unicursal formation. Whereas the crop circles are not, they're just pretty patterns.
They're pretty patterns. They're sacred geometry. And you know, lots of debate about what they are, why they're for, how they're made, so on and so forth. I have made some crop circles a couple of times with consent from the farmer, because I would be super pissed if a whole bunch of my crop was suddenly flattened and useless, which does happen to some farmers. But we made it in corn stalks after the corn had been harvested. So, you know, it was just, and it was a fun activity and a neat thing to do, but it was not the same as making a labyrinth, and definitely not the same as walking it.
Well, you I mean, you're looking at crop circles again, you can't walk them. There's
No,
no
they're not paths.
path.
Yeah, they're not paths. And also, a lot of them have the same effect as mazes in that they're walls. You can't see all of it. You can't, you know, it's not open. Labyrinths are always open.
Yeah. All right. Well, if nobody's got any more questions, I don't think there's much more we can talk about.
Go out and walk a labyrinth.
And go and check those websites out as well, as we said, because there's some they explain how labyrinths are actually made.
Yeah, which is
The seed pattern and things like that, which is very interesting.
yeah, and you can absolutely make your own labyrinths, finger labyrinths. You can draw them on paper. You can, you know, draw them outside. There, it doesn't require a complex skill. In fact, drawing them outside, two sticks and a string will do ya. You know, and just like casting big circles and other sacred geometry, you just need two sticks and a string to lay them out. They're not difficult. They don't require artistic skill or anything like that.
In fact, if you go and check out the link for the Labyrinth Society that's in the description, and mention they've got the little gifts that actually show you how they're drawn. I mean, if you take a simple one, it's just a cross with four dots. And then you start drawing circles from, you know, point to point, and you end up with a labyrinth. Really simple.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll have to look at many of those, because I was always taught that the lines you draw to connect everything needed to be like the rising sun. They come up in the east, they arc over, and they set in the west. And that was part of the symbolism involved with labyrinths. But looking through all of these kinds, that doesn't apply to every single thing in every single way. Of course, those are the curvy as compared to the square ones.
Yeah, actually, it was mentioned that the classical labyrinths were right facing. So you'd have that motion of the rising sun, as you were saying. Whereas the modern, the I don't know where we start with the modern, whether it's the medieval coming into modern times.
Yeah.
But it's said that the modern ones are left facing. Most of them.
I wonder why that is. I mean, you know, there's also the debate on if the labyrinths are aligned to the solstices. Like a couple of them are aligned so that the sun illuminates the center. Well, then they wouldn't have been used at other times? I don't think so. You couldn't have gotten a whole bunch of people there in the center right for the solstice moment. That moment doesn't last terribly long. It's like maybe 15 minutes if you know, on the solstices it's longer, on the equinoxes it's shorter. I don't know. It's interesting. I mean, I know they're useful as a witchcraft tool. I know they're super useful as a group ritual tool, because, like I said, you don't have any choice. You're going to meditate when you go through a labyrinth. It doesn't matter whether you want to. It doesn't matter whether you feel you can get into it or not. It doesn't matter whether you are actually walking or consciously aware, you know, moving your body in this way through these sacred patterns results in this state.
Forced meditation.
I know that sounds terrible, but I've heard lots and lots of people who have wanted to try to learn to meditate and feel that they can't do it, and, you know, have said to me in meditation classes, well, can't you just, like, force me to do it so I know what it's like? Yes, I can. But we need a big space. And some sticks and string.
Yeah. Ooh, I wonder if I can get hold of the complex governing body and ask them if I can make a labyrinth in the estate.
I mean, a lot of places go for them because they're beautiful. Yeah. You know, they're like you were saying, they're people put them in their gardens.
Yeah, very attractive.
Yeah, beautiful to look at. Just humans like those repeated things, and we like curvy things. Both of those we find pleasing aesthetics. So labyrinths work very well for that.
Yeah. All right, then. It doesn't look like anybody's got any questions or comments. So we are going to have a shorter one today. All right, so I think next week we are going to do the Sabbat, and then the week after we'll do the astrology. We'll compromise that way.
We'll do both. So,
yes.
Yeah. Let us know in Facebook or Discord in the Wildwood Temple if there's anything you'd like to see particularly in the astrology episodes. I'm not promising we'll get it in there, 'cause I don't know. But I'd love to hear what it is you want to see. We'll see what we can do.
Yep. So go check out the links in the description, or the link tree specifically for the Black Hat chat. And if you want to, and also go and vote for what's on the telly for this month, the public viewing of one of the two that we do each month. But if you want to watch both reviews of TV series and movies, that we do on Patreon or Ko-fi go to those channels. It's only $3 for the membership there, so
$3 a month. We put out 2 reviews a month, and you get to watch all the back catalog when you join. So
yeah, and they're fun.
Yeah, we're goofy.
We have a good laugh with some of them. We go off rambling like we usually do,
and we actually do find practical witchcraft in quite a few of them. I'm not going to say everyone. We try. I try very hard to find something. But
even in the ones that there is no evidence stuff, we find something.
Yep, yep. Learn from your environment.
All right, and we'll see you next week.
Bye.
Have a good one, everybody. Bye-bye.